through Danish drug consumption room, health equity for people who use drugs.
Okay, so my name is Eva Thund, and I'm from the Metropolitan University College in Copenhagen, Denmark. Together with my two colleagues, Lena Kappel and Jette Theiner, we have carried out this project about Danish drug consumption rooms. We appreciate you giving the opportunity to present it here, and it is a part of a larger study. Our research has to do with human rights. The Declaration of Human Rights covers the right to health and medical care, as well as social services. This is also in Sustainable Development Goals, number 3, ensuring health and healthy lives and promoting well-being at all ages for all people. And if you read further into the SDGs, you can find people with substance use under the goal number 3. For illicit drug users, this human right is a challenge. The United Nations Office on Drug and Crime reports that 13 million people inject drugs worldwide. Illicit drug use is associated with a range of social and environmental harms. The lack of a safe environment in which to take their drugs pose a high risk to these people, and they have a higher rate of sickness and a higher mortality and a lower life expectancy than the background population. But we need to look at the barriers to health care to which these people are exposed to. They are known to be medically underserved. The cost associated with medical treatment, as well as the stigma and discrimination within the care setting, are known to hinder access to care. Criminal sanctions against drug users pose further barriers. We have a long history with stigma on people who use drugs, regarding their situation as if it was their own fault, and therefore they do not deserve this basic human right to be met. But what if drug users weren't criminals, but considered as sick people? How would we treat those affected by addiction? That's why we have implemented the concept of harm reduction. Harm reduction is a set of practical strategies and ideas aimed at reducing the negative consequences associated with drug use. It refers to practices like drug testing or drug consumption rooms, or policies like implementing laws or decriminalization, or programs like needle exchange programs, opiate substitution, or heroin-assisted treatment. Drug consumption rooms are highly targeted services within a wider network of drug services. They often operate in separate areas located in existing facilities for drug users or the homeless, or some operate as standalone facilities. The first legally sanctioned drug consumption room was established in Bern in Switzerland in 1986. And here we see the number of drug consumption rooms we have in Europe. But as we speak here, many more are opening around the globe. In Denmark, the first effort to establish a drug consumption room was in fact an act of civil disobedience in 2011. This is one of the two ambulances that were bought by these civil disobedience, and they were remodeled into mobile drug consumption rooms. As you see, there were 4 places for injecting. It's the chairs there, and volunteer nurses and doctors welcomed drug users to safe injection. 1 year later, the Danish government decided to allow for the operation of drug consumption rooms, and written into the law, they argued that every person should have the possibility to take part in society and that no one should be excluded. They wished to stop marginalization, undignified living conditions, and reduce death by overdose. No need to say, we're quite proud that it was written into the law. In a drug consumption room, you can receive treatment of potential intoxication or overdose. There's access to clean needles and syringes, hand wash, cleaning of the skin, and there are nurses to assist in injecting techniques and healthcare. Since the effects of drug consumption room has been proven in many peer-reviewed studies, our study here set out to look at what it exactly it is that the staff do to bridge the gap to health services. So the purpose of this study was to examine how staff work to build bridge to health and social services in order to improve health equity among people who use drugs. Altogether, we did more than 250 hours of observation, participant observation. We did 25 staff semi-structured interviews and 42 drug user interviews and organized the data using the NVivo software program. These are the results and some of the drug user statements. The clients of the drug consumption rooms experience being met by a staff in a way which makes the drug users feel socially accepted in a secure place. They state that it's freedom from being hunted by the police, it's safety and security in case of overdose. This picture is a well-known drug addict called Kolle in Copenhagen. It's from a newspaper. He died this year, but he lived a long life on the streets, struggling with drug use, and he left behind his dog Odin, and he was well known having trouble injecting. So for him, the drug consumption rooms were a very good place. This is a picture from one of our drug consumption rooms, and the professionals in these rooms, they work towards health equity by establishing relationships, thereby opening possibility for the clients to receive supervision in safer injecting techniques, hygiene, and disease prevention. The clients say that it's a free space and it works like a safe haven for them. This is a picture of the slots where you can sit and do your drug consumption. There are three places for injecting in this room. And here are some of the staff statements. Establishing relationships was a crucial part of the professional's work. It became clear that it could often be challenged because of time pressure, short meetings, and lack of possibilities of intimacy. This is a quote from a nurse. The drug consumption rooms are a fantastic offer, both in relation to health and social aspects to these very marginalized people. We can offer something that makes it possible to improve health a little bit, and give them a room where they have comfort and peace.
2 more minutes.
We saw that the staff managed to establish relationship with the individual drug user using a step-by-step process and often over a long period of time. This nurse says the entire bridge building takes place when you sit there and you have the conversations with them. You see there's something, anything, from trouble injecting, offering health advice, or talking about living conditions. That way, this place is an excellent contact place. Meetings often last only a few seconds, but still the staff intended to establish a relationship. We coined them as micro-meetings. The relation starts when they enter the door. It's created by the fact that we have to hand them the needles. I say hi, and if I don't know their name, I ask. That's the start. The conversation takes off from there. One nurse describes the meetings as golden moments. Sometimes they come and ask if it's okay that they just come to talk, and sometimes they forget to take their drugs. And then this kind of magic occurs. We have these golden moments. We actually mean something for them. We show them respect. They also have autonomy and integrity that has to be respected. This leads us to the conclusion of our research, which is that building relationships are the premises. Through this, it's possible to attain social inclusion and accept, which leads to the important bridge building. Building relationship to these most vulnerable and marginalized drug users in the drug consumption rooms turns high-risk situations into low-risk. Thank you very much for your time.